Coming to the beauty of the arguments, this is the one where we need everyone to really listen in, to see the beauty of how the Ahlul Bayt interpret the Holy Quran. A person comes by the name of Zurara to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi as-salatu wasalam, says, "O Imam," he says, "is there a difference between qatil and maut?" So if you ask a person, you know, what's the difference between qatil and maut, they say, you know, this means death, this means death. Imam al-Sadiq replies to Zurara, says, "Zurara," he says, "qatil is not like maut, and maut is not like qatil. Qatil, to be killed. Maut is to die." He says, "Likewise within the Holy Quran," proving, he says, "whomever has been killed has to return to taste death." What's the concept? Imam Sadiq, whomever has tasted being killed, qatil, has to return in order for him to taste what? Maut. Where do we find this? Is it Allah makes a distinction within the Holy Quran? When he says about Rasulullah, "Afa'immata aw qutil." Distinction or no distinction? "Afa'immat," if he dies, "aw qutil," or is killed. Then how do we understand that whoever has been killed needs to return to taste death? In the Holy Quran again, "Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut." Every soul has to taste death. But the ones that have tasted being killed hasn't tasted death. So they need to return in order for them to taste death. And the Holy Quran, what does it say? Those that have been killed haven't died. What does it say? "لا تحسبن الذين قتلوا في سبيل الله أموات بل أحياء عند ربهم يرزقون." Assisting which concept? The concept of الرجعه. This aspect that we understand of shuhada. Now many of us would look at this concept and say this aspect of shaheed. When you ask anyone, they'll think of the person that has attained martyrdom on the battlefield. And they say that this person has attained the rank of shaheed. That this person of shaheed has particular characteristics that he attains when he attains that rank, or she attains that rank. What are these particular characteristics? As an example, in this world, they are tahir. For example, when a shaheed or a person attains shahada on the battlefield, one of the things is that they're tahir, you do not wash their bodies. Anyone else that dies, you have to wash their body. For a shaheed, you don't wash their body. They're purified. They have particular aspects, even as their body does not decay. When they opened his grave, they said that that cloth that Imam al-Hussein tied on his head when it was split, a person of the ulama tried to remove that particular cloth. He said, "I saw the blood seeping from his head." Preserved. In the barzakh, which Latif spoke about yesterday, shuhada have a different rank. As he referred that people, if they're righteous, in the time of barzakh, there are particular moments where they're allowed, if they're righteous, to visit their loved ones. And they only visit their loved ones when they're given permission. Whether it be once a week, once a month, every Thursday night, every Friday, whatever have you, they are given permission. The higher your rank, the more permission you're given. Then there comes the rank of the shuhada, that they are able and are allowed to visit their loved ones whenever they want, wherever they want. Why? Because they've attained that rank. And the hereafter, they say that there's particular doors towards heaven. One is only for those which are known as a shuhada. So many ranks, so many merits for these particular people. Now take this concept of shaheed, and let's play around with the words. Shaheed, when someone comes and tells you, And a shaheed comes from shahada, for example. Root word. Someone says shaheed istashhad. Shahada. If I tell someone that knows Arabic, what's shahada mean? When I say do a tashahud, you say ashhadu, for example, and la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, wa ashhadu anna Aliyan, waliyullah, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So all of a sudden, this word can be played around with, saying the shahada can be something that I bear witness. As in, as an example, when we say the shahada, we are saying that, you know, we understand that we want to bear witness that Allah is one, of the prophethood, of the imamate, and we spend our whole life trying to instill that which we bear witness to within our lives. And the interesting concept there is when you are born, the adhan and the iqama in your ears. But when you die, that salat that they pray on you, is there a adhan and iqama or not? It's as if to say, you know what, we've told you when you were first born, instill this shahada and this particular aspect of bear witnessing within your life and every action. And when you die, it's too late. Shahada, to bear witness. Why do these people that have died in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given that title? Because not everyone's given that. People that have fought alongside Rasulullah and died, they've come towards Rasulullah, look at this person that died defending you. He says, for example, in one of the battles, he says, no, that person hasn't attained this rank of shahada. He says, why? He says, he's only fought alongside me to protect his own wealth. He doesn't have that rank. When we say these people have the highest rank, let's play on these words. Some people are of the opinion that say, when we say shuhada, it's to say that they are bear witnessing to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every stage after they die. As in they bear witness to the mercy of Allah in barzakh. They bear witness to the mercy of Allah in the hereafter. They bear witness in many aspects of merits that they have. Question. How is it when we say that Imam al-Sadiq says very beautifully, Man mahadha al-Iman mahadha, the best of the best are those that have attained that rank of shahada that would return to bear witness to Allah's mercy and justice in this world before the hereafter. So the shuhada will be those that would return to bear witness Allah's mercy and justice, how He establishes justice and eradicates tyranny. And the interesting point there is, who is the first person that would return? Who can answer me? What did we say? Imam al-Hussein. What is he known as? Imam al-Hussein, what is he known as? Sayyid al-Shuhada. The master, what we say, of the martyrs. The master of the shuhada can also mean another context, the master or the first person that would return to bear witness to the justice of Allah being established in this world before the hereafter. Let's take this particular position and ask ourselves the question. If I want to be of these people that return alongside the Imam, we've understood it's only a group of people, the best of the best, which will see and bear witness to Allah's justice, and the worst of the worst that thought to themselves, there's no justice of Allah, that I can do whatever I want. Imagine a person like Shimr or Yazid returning to see how Allah establishes justice. A person like Fir'aun returning to see how Allah establishes his justice. We want to be of those people, but maybe we are lacking one way or another. Is there a way around it? Is there a way that I may return alongside my Imam? We read Dua al-Ahad, this particular phrase. فَإِنْ حَالَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَهُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي جَعَلْتَهُ عَلَى عَبَادِكَ حَتْمًا مَقْضِيًا. Oh Allah, if there comes a time That death separates me from being alongside my Imam. What did we say? فَأَخْرِجْنِي مِنْ قَبْرِي مُعْتَزِرًا كَفَنِي شَاعِرًا سَيْفِي مُلَبِّي مُجْرِدًا قَنَاتِي مُلَبِّيًا دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي. The tradition, when you read it prior, the Imam says, whomever wants to be resurrected to fight alongside Imam Sahib al-Asri wal-Zaman for 40 days, let him recite this dua. And he will return back to be alongside Imam Sahib al-Asri wal-Zaman.